Okay, welcome to part two of the tutorial. So, in this part, we're going to cover all of the lead guitar parts. If you remember my original video with the cover of the two split screen, the two guitars, this will be the one on the right hand side. Now, there are lots of places where there are some great lead bits, including that crazy solo. But don't be surprised if we're actually backing up the rhythm parts for a lot of this, because as I said before, there are up to four guitars at any one time on this track. So you need to be able to fatten the sound out. So there'll be places, there'll be occasions where we'll be playing rhythm parts as well, just higher up the neck, just to kind of fatten everything out. Okay, with that being said, we're actually going to be silent for the first 10 bars of this during the entire intro section where the rhythm guitar is doing all of this and the big descending run. So we don't come in until the drums come in with the verse. So let's take a look at that now. So this verse was played with a slide. Now I'm pretty sure he's in standard tuning still, but to be honest with you, I find the whole idea of kind of performing it live and putting a slide on quickly, taking it off quickly, it can be done, but it's a lot easier if you've got three other guitar players backing out things for you. If you're playing it and you're the second guitarist, there's a lot more pressure on you to maintain the continuity. So what I've done is done a version that doesn't require a slide, so you don't have to worry too much about it. And we're actually going to use pre-bends to get the same kind of sound. So what we first hear is this ninth fret on the G string. And then you're going to hear the 12th fret sliding back to around the ninth fret. Now the way we're going to do it is we're going to pick the 9 and then, you know, really big bend. But what you're going to do is you're going to bend that without picking it. This is called a pre-bend. Then pick it while it's up and bring it down. So we're going, and it just gives it kind of a slide-like quality, because of course when you bend, you no longer hear the notchy quality that the guitar has when you change frets, when you slide across frets. It's very smooth. So that's a really great way of emulating slide guitar. So you've done that, you've picked the 9, you've pre-bent up to 12 and brought it back down, and then you're going to play 8 on the G string. You do the same 9th fret pre-bend up to 12, and then you play 7. This is all on the G string. Same pre-bend, and then 6. So let me pull that together. Okay, now on the cover version I just for the sake of variation, occasionally I wouldn't do a pre-bend, I'd actually do a normal bend up and down, so like this. So sometimes I did a pre-bend there, sometimes a normal bend. So it just shows you you can play around with this a little bit to get, you know, a bit of variety in the sound. So we finish up here at the 6th fret. The next part is we're going to go to the 5th fret on the G string. And you're going to slide up to 9. And when you get to 9, you're going to try and time it so that kind of as you arrive at 9, you re-pick it. And then the same thing up to 12 on the same string. So from the start, okay, so that's going on whilst the verse guitar is doing all of that stuff. We then get to the riff. Now this riff is all of that, if you remember from the first video. Now what we're going to do is we're going to follow the same rhythm, we're going to play different notes. So actually we're going to stay on the G string and we're going to go to the 4th fret and we're going to go like this. Okay, so let's have a look at that. That's 4 on the G, 6, 7, and then you're going to go up to 9 and do the big bend up to 12 again, and bring it down and then play 9 and stay on it, let it ring out. And you're going to let that ring out for a full bar. Okay, so from the start of that, Now, as that riff repeats twice, so does our little lead line. The second time it repeats, when the rhythm guitar goes to the chords, we're going to play some notes. So we're ended here at 9. So you're going to re-pick the 9 on the first chord. Then you're going to slide up to 12 for the second chord, and then down to 6 for the third chord. So if I play that whole section, pick, chord, chord, chord. Okay, now as we go back into the verse, it's going to be exactly the same approach as last time, but just before we go into it, you hear the second fret briefly on the G string, and what you do is pick it and slide all the way up to 9. Okay, so we've just ended 2, 3, 4, 1, and then it's the verse again. All of those bits again. So we've gone through the verse and with the pre-bends, we've gone through the little lead part that works underneath the heavy riff, then you go back to the verse, this time sliding into the first note from the second fret, then we go back through the heavy riff again. So the next new bit of guitar playing is a bit of rhythm playing, and this comes over the top of our riff from the rhythm part. And what we're essentially going to be doing this time around is mirroring the high part. So we're going to go. So this is just actually a repetition of the bit that was at the top of that riff. But even though they're the same notes, it's on a different string, and it's just going to kind of thicken the sound out. Same rhythm applies. I'm using my first and fourth finger for the first bit, because what that does is it flattens my hand out and means that I can mute the other strings, so with my picking hand I can be a bit looser and strum at the strings. This is a bit more kind of a funk style way of playing. You can see I'm just sliding, my little finger's the note that's fretting the note, but I'm sliding my whole hand up as I do this, so it mutes the other strings. So that's the riff. And we're going to play that 8 times to match precisely the amount of times you hear the riff in the first time through with the rhythm guitar as well. So up next is kind of the first solo of the song. So this is going on over the top of the really nice ringing. And what we've got is this. So let's take a look at this. Alright, so we're starting on the note C on the A string. First fret, first finger. So it's the third fret. And you're going to pick it 3 times. And then you're going to bring your third finger down onto the fifth fret on the A string and pick it and slide up to 7. And then your first finger's going to drop down a string onto the D string and play the fifth fret on the D. So we've gone like this. Now we're going to re-pick this note again and then very quickly go to the 7th fret on the same string. So these are both on the D string. And as I hit that 7, as you can see, I'm doing a bend. Now bending is notoriously difficult on the thickest 3 strings. They don't particularly like to be bent, and they take a lot more bending to get to another note than the thin strings do. So bend down. This is a strong motion for your hand, this grabbing motion. This is how our hands evolved. It's much better than the pushing motion. So you're pulling the note down and you're aiming roughly for that 9th fret. If you don't quite get it, to be honest with you, this happens so fast, I think you probably end up getting away with it, but it doesn't mean that you can not try in the first place to get the note. So that's what we're aiming for there. And then we're going to re-pick the note without the bend, back off to 5, and 7 on the A string, and then you go back onto the D string, pick 5 and hammer on 7. So we've gone like this. So let me show you that again. Now, after the bend, the 7-5, you can either do them as a pull-off, where you pick 7, pull off to 5, before going to the A string note, or you could pick them separately. It's up to you there. So that was with the pull-off. That's with the pick notes. You can hear just a bit more clarity if you pick the notes, but you probably feel it's a bit smoother, maybe easier to do if you do it as a pull-off. So you can do that riff twice. 2, 3, 4. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go to an octave at the 3rd fret of the A string, which is a C. So it's 3 on the A, nothing on the D, 5 on the G. And you're going to pick that and let it ring out for 2 beats. 1, 2. Slide up to the 7th fret. So this is now 7 on the A, nothing on the D, 9 on the G. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4. And then we're going to go to an A major chord here. So I'm on the 6th string with my first finger, fret 5. And then it's 7, 7 on the A and D strings with my 3rd and 4th finger. And then I've got my 2nd finger, fret 6 on the G. So it looks a bit like a bar chord. But I'm just not barring with my first finger, I'm just using that one finger. And I'm going to strum that 6 times, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then mute, 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 mute at the end. So if you remember back from the rhythm part, this is going to match up exactly over the bit down there. And this is kind of the whole point of having the two guitars. They can spread out over the neck a little bit more and fatten sounds up, but also extend chords, make them bigger. So the first chord, that was the highest note. In this one, that's the highest note, so together you get a combined effect that's a bit bigger, as well as still fattening up the sound with the low end. Right, so this time we're going back to our riff. This time we're going to play it twice. Now the rhythm guitar is going to keep this going for quite a while, but we're going to just do it twice to start off with, and also we're going to play it with some extra notes just to start to expand the sound. So before we were just mirroring some notes from down here, now we're adding some higher notes. So now you're playing the middle two strings, so it's 7-7, 9-9, mute, mute, same thing. And then this time it goes both 9s on the middle strings, both 11s, both 12s. So before we just had those D string notes, now we've got the same notes on the G string. And again, together you're just fattening the sound out a bit. Now, the way I like to play this is use my first finger to bar the 7s on the middle two strings, but then all the other notes to use my 3rd and 4th finger separately for each string. So I'm using my 3rd finger for the D string, 4th finger for the G. So we've done that twice. Now we're going to get this really nice, interesting little diminished kind of flattened 5th power chord that sounds like this. And then you get a cool little run at the end. This is quite a clashing, nasty sound, but in context of the song, it just provides a bit of texture, makes it sound a bit dissonant, is the musical word. We're up at the 8th fret on the D string with our first finger. Then we're going to play the 9th fret with our second finger on the G. And then our little finger's going to reach up and hit 11 on the B. You can hit this 4 times and try and strum it if you can. Now the way you're going to have to do this is try and mute the other strings. So I'm using my little finger to just bump into the high E, and similarly I'm using my thumb to try and stop the thick string from ringing out. So you can hit that 4 times, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you're going to slide the same shape down to the 5th fret. So now it's 5 on the D, 6 on the G, and then 8 on the B. Same 4 strums. So we've got, then you go back up 4 strums, back down 4 strums, and then we get a cool little run. So the run is right down here at the 2nd fret on the D string. You're going to pick it twice, and then it's 4-2. I'm using my 1st and 3rd finger here. And then you're going to move your first finger up to the 4th fret this time, and you're going to go 4, 5, so I'm using fingers 1 and 2 this time, and then your 3rd finger comes into play on the G string, fret 6. So I've gone, let me do this again slowly, fingers are quite important here. Once more. You're going to be quite tempted to go, but then you can still play it that way, but you're doing it with weaker fingers, you'll probably find it a little harder. So sometimes it's easier to take a position shift to allow you to play something a bit smoother later on. So we put that together. So from there, we're going to go back and join our rhythm guitar friend with the riff again. And we're going to be doing it with our nice larger twin string one that we've been doing on both the middle strings. We're going to be doing this 8 more times. We're going to try and make the song step up a bit. Now, on the original song, what you've got is one guitar hitting a low E chord, one guitar kind of up here. Now, what we're going to try and do is emulate that sound, but keep our little harmony part going. So what we want is this. Now, you might find this tricky. If you do, you can do two things. You can either keep playing the small version, or you can just hit an E power chord. So this is 7th fret on the A, 9 on the D, 9 on the G. Or you can hit the E power chord down here, open E, 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, and so on. But if you do want to try my combined version, what you need to do is this. You can use your first finger to bar the A string at 7, the D string at 7, and the G string at 7. You can use your third finger to play the 9th fret on the D string. So that's going to be covering up the middle barred note. So far we've got 0 on the 5th string, 7 on the A, 9 on the D, 7 on the G, using the bar. So you're going to hit that once, and then on the up strum, you're going to add your little finger down onto the G string at fret 9. So you've got... Okay, then you're going to do 2 more strums, with just the low thin, the low thick string, sorry. So you've gone... Then you can do the same thing again. And then this is the reasonably tricky bit. This is going to test your little finger. You can do one strum of the chord as it is, so 0, 7, 9, 9. Then you're going to reach up your little finger to fret 11, so I'm 11 on the G string. So now the chord is 0, 7, 9, 11. Quite a nice chord. One strum of that, and then extra long reach up to 12 on the G. So we've gone like this. More. That's a good way of kind of fattening the sound up for that section as it builds up. You don't, like I said, you can try the easier version if you want, but I just like the way that worked on my cover. So you're going to repeat that another 8 times. So on. Alright, let's look at what comes next. So at this next point, the rhythm guitar is playing that lovely descending run. So for, at least for the first run through, we're going to copy that exactly. So refer to the other video if you haven't already, hopefully you have, to play those chords. I'm not going to spend any time this time, you know, working that back out again with you. After that first run through, we start to play kind of the second solo-y idea. Now, this is a really nice little theme. It's a bit similar to the first solo, and the idea is we're going to be kind of moving this pattern to start on different notes. So let me play it for you. Okay, so let's break this down. Alright, so the first chunk sounds like this. Alright, so first note is the opening string. You're going to pick it, and then pick it again, and immediately pick the 5th fret on the A string, and slide it up to the 7th. I'm using my 3rd finger for this slide, because it puts me in the right position then. Onto the D string, fret 5. Then you're going to re-pick the 5th fret twice more on the D, and pick 7 on the D and pull off to 5. And we're going to end the phrase at fret 7 on the A string. So we do that once more, nice and slow. Okay, next phrase starts at the 5th fret on the A string. So you're going to use your first finger now, pick it once, and then once more, and then 7 slide to 9, all on the A string. Then we're going to go onto the D string, fret 7 this time, with our first finger. Then you're going to re-pick it twice more, pick 9 on the D, pull off to 7, and then end on 9 on the A. So you can see that's got the same kind of shape, other than the fact that it didn't start on an open note. It's got the same melodic shape to it. So both of those together. Alright, let's carry on. On to a C this time. So it's roughly the same shape we just played, but starting on 3rd fret. So 3rd fret on the A string. But this time we're going to pick it twice more. And then 5 slide 7. 5 on the D string. So that's. And then 2 more picks. Pick 7 and pull off to 5. End on 7 on the A. So hopefully getting the idea of this pattern now. So all 3 of those together. And we end with an ever so slightly different pattern here. So it's A string open. And then once more. And then pick 2 on the A string. Slide up to 4. And then 2 on the D string. So up until that point it's the same kind of pattern. But then you stop there. Now, the first time through, at that point, you're going to play an F power chord, which is the 1st fret on the E string, and the 3rd on the D, 3rd on the A, 3rd on the D. So 1, 3, 3. You're going to play that twice. So that would be like this. Then we do the whole sequence again. This time, we just want 1 strum of the F. Okay, so the first time was 2 strums, second time 1 strum. Then again, we go back to the start, do the whole pattern again, and the last time, we're going to follow that stab of the F that we did on the rhythm, where you start with a down mute, and then do the up strum as the F. So the last one through will sound like this. Okay, so that's down mute, up F. In the rhythm section on part 1 of my video, I went through the really cool octave section. Good news is, you're just going to do exactly the same as that. So, head back to the video if you haven't already, check that bit out. You're going to mirror it exactly, which is really great because it just fattens the sound up. From there then, we're going to be moving towards the nasty solo. Before we do that, you're going to be playing our slightly enlarged version of the riff, which, if you remember, is the middle 2 strings, 7, 9, 7, 9, 9, 11, 12. So you're going to do that twice, and then it's solo time. Alright, Fearsome Solo Time. Now, this solo is really hard to hear on the record, which is probably one of the reasons that not a lot of the other YouTube guitar tutors have covered it too much, or, you know, not in much detail. I've had a listen to it, and I'm pretty pleased with what I've ended up with. So, we've got the position from the Letterman show, but he doesn't actually play what he played on the record there, so I didn't pay too much attention to it. I've stuck mostly with what you hear on the studio recording. Now, on the recording, it fades in, so it's hard to hear where it starts, and it fades out into unintelligible distortion, so it's very difficult to hear the ending. The middle bit, I'm pretty certain I know what it is. I've smoothed it off to make it kind of a bit more uniform, kind of what he was aiming for, perhaps, rather than what he ended up quite getting. Because, you know, when you've got really difficult with parts to play like this in the studio, it's very easy to fluff the odd note here or there. He's playing so many notes, most people aren't going to notice. And really, it's not the kind of solo where you're paying too much attention to every note. It's more of a textural device in the song. You know, it's not loud enough in the mix that the listener's meant to be having too much attention drawn to it. It's just there to create a pleasing texture. So, I'm pretty confident with what I've got at the end of the solo, but that's the part that people might disagree with me on. Perfectly happy for that to happen. It will always happen on YouTube or anywhere. Everyone has their own interpretations. So let's have a look at it. Okay, so we've got 32nd notes here. Now, that sounds scary, doesn't it? 32 notes per bar. Every four beats, you'll be playing 32 notes. That's essentially what that means. Now, the good news is we can break this down into some smaller patterns to learn. So the first pattern is 8 notes long, and it sounds like this. Okay. At speed, it's much quicker. But slow down. Doesn't sound impossible, does it? Let's have a look. We're on the B string. You're going to pick it open first, then hammer on 2 and then 3, same string. So 0, 2, 3 on the B. Then you're going to pick the high E string open, and then you're going to pick 3, 2, 0 on the B string. So pick the 3, pull off, pull off. So far it's only 3 picks with this hand. Okay, down, hammer, hammer, up, down, pull off, pull off. And then the last note is 3 on the G string. So start really slow. Each of these notes is even, that's what we're aiming for, even. Da, 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 da. Now that means I don't mind how fast it is, as long as it's even. It doesn't matter if it's really slow compared to full speed. That's better to me, because it's even, than, you know, you're trying to play it really quick and it's speeding up and slowing down, or you might miss a note. That's no good, that won't help anyone. So start that pattern slow. Now in the solo, we're going to do that pattern twice. Okay. Then we move to something that looks easy on paper, but is arguably a little harder. What this pattern is 0, 2, 0 on the B string. Again, hammer on and pull off. And then 3 on the G. So it's a shorter pattern, it's only 4 notes. Both of these things you can treat as separate exercises. You know, go and wind your family up, play it while they're trying to listen to their favourite TV show, trying to watch their favourite TV show. That'll get on their nerves, and it will help you. So make little exercises, use a metronome. So in the solo, you're going to do that second pattern 3 times like this. And then our last bit of this first bar is going to go, which is the open B string, and then 3, 2, 0 pull off on the G. So from the start, this is the whole first bar. Okay. There you go. Right, next bar. We're going to start roughly where we've left off, second fret on the G string. You're going to pick it and pull off to 0. Now we're doing this slightly slower than the 32nd notes before. Not much slower, but just slightly slower. You're going to pick 2 and pull off to 0. And then go to 2 on the D string. So, and then you're going to go back to the G string, and you're going to pick zero, hammer on and pull off two again, quick again like before, and then two on the D string again. So we've gone. Now for all of this bar mostly, I'm using my first and second finger now to really help with the string crossing. If you do it all with one finger, you're just giving it far too much work to do at the tempo you need to get this at. So that's always going to be easier than trying to use one finger to go between strings. Okay, so we've gone. And then this next bit's the kind of, I mean, all of this second bar really is reminiscent of the Long Road to Ruin solo. We're now going to go D string, 0, 2, 0, 2 on the A. And you do that twice. That's very Long Road to Ruin, isn't it? So we've gone, this is second bar. And then we slow it back down slightly again, and this is the last set of notes we need. So let's look at that. It's open D, two pull off to zero on the A string, three on the G on the E string, sorry, so the note G. And then back onto A, zero, and hammer on two, and you end on that third fret G note again. So that is. So the whole second bar sounds like this. So let's look at the whole solo, nice and slow. How fast? So take your time with it, no rush. Much better to get the rest of the song nailed and then spend 3 weeks trying to get this bit sounding good than try and rush the whole lot. Okay, let's move on. So this next part, I'm not entirely convinced. I think this might be the slide guitar, but at this point there is a lot going on the track. It's not just the four guitars, but you've got, you know, the crazy synth parts and all sorts of stuff. So the way I've got around this is I'm playing the middle two strings at the ninth fret, and over the course of a bar I'm bending it up. Okay, now it's more about hearing the note go up than it is about reaching a certain point with it. You're not aiming for anything in particular. I mean, I've put that it's a full tone bend in the tab, but you know, the idea is more that you just hear that kind of car, that motorbike revving kind of F1 engine kind of sound. You can bend up or down with this. And another thing that I'm doing in the recording is I'm strumming all the way through it. Now, I couldn't actually notate this in Guitar Pro. I've tried loads of different ways of doing it, but yeah, that's basically what you're going to be doing. You're going to be doing the bend, but you're going to be picking it as you're bending up as well. 16th notes, 1 eander, 2 eander, 3 eander, 4 eander, 1 eander, 2 eander, 3 eander, 4 eander. You're going to do this four times, and then we're going to move on right near the end now to the next bit, which is an octave at the note G. 10th fret on the A string, nothing on the D, and then 12 on the G. So those notes. And you're also going to be hitting the low E string. This is very noisy at this point. Now we're going to be hitting 16th notes still, so 1 eander, 2 eander, 3 eander, 4 eander. And you're going to do this for four bars. And so on, okay? So that's, you know, the track's really hitting its climax now. That's one of the ways we're going to fatten the sound out. From there, after you've done that four bars worth, you're going to have a pattern that follows the riff, essentially, but right up in the wee frets up here. So we've got this. So let's have a look at that. We're going to start off at the 12th fret on the A string, nothing on the D, 14 on the G. You're going to pick and slide up two frets, and then two mutes, and then the same thing again. So we've got, and then you're going to re-pick that note, so it's 14 on the A, 16 on the G. Move it up two frets, so now we're at 16 and 18. And then once more, so now we're at 17 and 19. Okay, so we've gone. You can do that four times. So that's the climax of the song done. We're going to end on our big riff. Now, the first four beats of this are identical to what the rhythm guitar are playing. On the recording, my tone is set up slightly differently on the two guitars. The rhythm guitar's not got as much gain. So the difference in tone between two guitars is going to be enough to make this feel big. But yeah, you can look at what I did on the rhythm part for that. Essentially, it's just a sloppier, messier version of the riff we did right near the start. The last chord is different, so I'm ending on this chord, which, objectively speaking, is a C-sharp diminished chord, but that's not really what's going on. The way you've got to think about this chord is you've just hit an A7 with the rhythm guitar, and you're trying to find some extra space further up the neck with some other notes that will work with it, just to make it sound like one huge chord. Now, if you look to what the riff was doing, it was going to go back to a 4 anyway. So basically, the way to think about this is you're just hitting that note that the riff wants to go to while the other guitar's tied up with an open chord. And then on top of that note, we're also sticking the top part of a dominant chord, which is what the other guitar's playing. So although, yes, it is a C-sharp diminished chord, really it's the melody note plus a little bit of chord. So let's have a look at it. It's 4 on the A string, then 5 on the D string, then little finger, so those were fingers 1 and 2, little finger at 6 on the G, and then third finger at 5 on the B. So you're going to hit that lettering out. Job done.